Hi, I'm Heather, and I am feeling not ready slash ready to tell another episode of Based on a True Story, The Alaska Years. So this story is about what ended up being my 17th birthday, and how I very nearly didn't survive the night. So we have to back up just a little bit. It was 1989, and the Exxon Valdez oil tanker disaster had happened in March. I I actually worked in the Prince William Sound two summers in a row, and so I was having a hard time remembering like which was which. But the first summer was 1989, when it was my 17th birthday, and my dad was the skipper of a fishing vessel called the Big Valley. And they decided that it was, since there was a lot of money to be made in the Prince William Sound trying to clean up that crude oil, and so fishing boats were all being taken out of the fishing grounds and sent to the Prince William Sound. So since it was summertime, by the time it was summer, I was ready to go work out there as a deckhand on the Big Valley. So what we used, I'll just back up for another second. What the boat was used for was we had cleaned the hold that normally fish would be in, and that was filled with fresh water. The whole deck was, filled with supplies from town. So we were a supply boat and kind of a hosting boat sometimes too. Anyway, that's enough detail about that. So we got an emergency call. It probably would have been on like June 16th, maybe the morning of the 17th. I'm sorry, June 12th, maybe the morning of the 11th. An extremely important family member to my dad, who I also will sometimes call Pete, was literally on his deathbed. And the only way that Pete would be able to get a chance to say goodbye to who was his uncle Tom, like somebody who had been so pivotal in his life, the only way that he could possibly get to his bedside before he died was if we immediately left where we were stationed out in the Prince William Sound, ran overnight to Valdez, hopped on a plane, went back to Homer to drop me off, and then actually I think he left straight from Valdez. I flew by myself. We had to leave immediately, and so we did. And we were taking turns at the wheel, and the other deckhand, it was his turn to be at the wheel and watch for rocks and make sure that we stayed on course and everything was hunky-dory. The rest of us were asleep. I was in my stateroom. And I woke up all of a sudden and I was no longer in my bunk. I was on the floor. Something had happened that had been so violent that I was thrown out of my bunk and onto the floor. And I heard a lot of sound, and my brain could not quite grasp what the sounds were and what was happening. So I went out of my old room and I looked to the right, and in the galley, cupboards. Normally we would normally secure the cupboards if we expected, some sort of high seas, but there was no wind. It was easy running. There was no reason for everything to be clipped closed. And so there was stuff all over the floor that had just come flying out of the cupboards. The fridge door was open. Stuff was flying out of the fridge. And I'm starting to come to the realization, like, a lot of force is required for all of this to happen. And I went out onto the deck. And it was, since it was summertime, there was daylight. I had no idea what time it was. I was guessing maybe 1 a.m., 2 a.m. And I was looking around the boat from the deck, and I was like, we're really close to a lot of rocks. Like, that's a rock right there. Why are there so many rocks around the boat? It's like recounting this is like bringing up some of the sensations in my body, and it's incredibly uncomfortable. And I've almost talked myself out of telling this story multiple times today, because I know that I'm going to at some level re-experience it, and it was fucking terrifying. We're out in the middle of nowhere. There's nobody's gonna come and rescue us. There's not gonna be just some boat that's gonna come by and save us. So as I'm standing there on the deck, looking around and going, holy shit, there is no reason that we should be so close to rocks. Then I start hearing my dad's voice, and the tone that is coming out of him is not one that I have ever heard, because it is, there is so much fear in it, but also like a, we're doing this fucking now, like 911, all, you know, like get here now. See, it's becoming somewhat challenging for me to speak because of the experience of kind of remembering this. I could hear his voice. He was extremely loud. He was extremely angry. He was swearing. I mean, he always did that, but it was a particularly like flavor, like colorful swearing. I could tell he was coming from the engine room. So I got there as quickly as I could. I could hear water. That in a way that I shouldn't have been able to hear water. Like you really fucking tune into your senses when you're working on a boat. Just the slightest change in what the engine sounds like is something that would wake me up, because I'd be like, why did the engine change? What's happened? We're slowing down, we're speeding up, you know, so many details. And so I knew that hearing the water I was hearing was not okay. I believe at that time he said something along the lines of, go check out that motherfucker who's at the wheel. Make sure that you put him in the shed. There's a shed on the deck. Lock him in, because if I see him, I'm going to fucking kill him. I didn't know why. I had no idea why he was saying this. I just knew that I was going to go up, get the other deckhand, and go put him in this little box on the deck to save his life. Remember, I'm 17. Actually, I'm not. Yeah, I just turned 17 a couple of hours before this is all happening. So I'm still like super fucking unclear what's happened. I go put him in that room and let him know, like, we'll check on you later, but don't come out of here. You will not survive if Pete sees you. Pete had me go look. Go look over the bow, like leaning off the bow as far as I could to see if I could tell where the hole actually was so that I could come back and report it to him. And I described exactly where it was. I had to keep going and looking multiple times because he would ask another question and I would go check, and I would come back and I would say, okay, this is what, and so finally after the detail that I was able to give him, because he didn't want to leave the wheel again, was, we identified that the hole that had been torn in the hull was mostly in a water tank. There was a portion, a small portion of the hole that was going directly into the engine room. But luckily, the majority of the hole was in the water tanks, was in a water tank. So there was already supposed to be water there. So we just got underway. And we started really, really slowly at first, and I would keep running forward and see what I could see and then go back and give a report, and over again until he felt comfortable with letting me go see if I could clean out the galley and kind of tend to some of the bumps and bruises that I had sustained when I was thrown out of my bunk. I'm sure at some point I took some food to the guy in the box. And as soon as we got to town, he had called ahead and said, make sure that there's a plane, get us booked on the next flights. He flew straight to Seattle. He did make it to his Uncle Tom's bedside before Uncle Tom passed away. I went straight to Homer, and my mom picked me up, and I went to bed the moment I got home. And that's how I spent my 17th birthday, sleeping. I was really, really thankful to be in my own bed. And I remember waking up once and because the phone had rang, and I heard my mom saying, oh yeah, you're right, Heather did come home early. I'll tell her that you called to tell her happy birthday, but she's sleeping, I'm not gonna wake her up. And I just remember being both like really thankful that a friend had called to wish me happy birthday, and also just so fucking thankful to be alive and in my bed and to hear my mom's voice. And I, once again, not for the first time, escaped what felt like certain death. All right. Well, thank you for letting me share that story with you. I'd be curious if anyone has had anything similar, or, you know, what came up for you while I was telling the story. I'm always curious what it feels like to be on the receiving end of one of my wild-ass stories. Have a great day.